You guys are good this morning. You're ready. Ahead of time. Will you stand with me? And why don't we start our service by lifting our hands and welcoming the presence of the Lord into this place. Jesus, we worship you, Lord. And oh God, we thank you, Lord, for your presence this day, Jesus, for the gathering together of your people. We worship and we magnify you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise your wonderful name. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Touch us this morning, Jesus. Give us your peace, oh God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. We worship you, Lord. We worship you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. How many of you have found that to be true? Nobody can touch you like Jesus can. Hallelujah. And, you know, that touching is not just one way. Jesus is affected by our prayers, by the status of our heart, if you will. And he wants us to bring all our needs to him. In fact, his word says that we should cast all our cares upon him because he cares for us. And we're going to take those cares to him this morning, just a couple of spoken. Pray for Sister and Brother, Sister Pat Shaw and Bill Shaw there traveling. And so pray for traveling mercies. And they're kind of going down the southern way, so I'm not sure if the weather's going to affect them at all, but and also for her healing. Pray for Brother Alice Penn's niece, Monica Cole, and Susie's little baby Noah is sick, so pray for Noah as well. If you have a need this morning, yes, you have two.
The weather is hurting today. We would lift her up in prayer that God would touch her. And then also, Sister Iris mentioned to me, Shayla.
Shay Love.
Her grandniece, I think it is, her great niece, we figured it out. She has a need as well. We need to pray for her. So those two prayer requests.
Okay. Yes,
ma'am.
Sister Mary Shallow and Ella Thomas.
That's right. Sister Ella is fighting cancer. Mary's recovering from surgery. So do pray. All right, Karen. Okay, one of your nieces. All right. You have a need this morning, besides those that have been lifted up. Why don't you lift your hand Let's look around. Let's agree with one another. Jesus, we thank you, Lord, for the privilege of bringing our needs to you, Lord. And God, we ask that you would minister, Lord, to those who are sick in their bodies, Lord Jesus. Oh, we know that you're the mighty physician, Jesus, and you can do what healthcare providers can't, Jesus. You're the creator of this body, Jesus, and you do miracles, Jesus. Minister, God, to those who are hurting their hearts, those who are struggling, Jesus. You know what the needs are this morning, God. Minister to each and every one of us, Lord, and to all those who are signified by our hands raised. We ask it all in the wonderful name of Jesus. You say amen? Amen. All right. Why don't you get out of your pews and greet one another for just a few minutes.
For just a thought this morning, that made up for a while ago. Got a question for you. Are you religiously Christian? Are you religiously Christian? According to S.I. Hayakawa, who was a well-known English professor in Southern California and a former United States Senator, the word religious can describe anyone, from the man who observes nothing more than the minimum obligations of his faith, to a person who is genuinely devoted to a way of life that reflects a deep love for God, as well as adherence to the tenets of one of the systems set up to worship God. And that ends his quote. In other words, religious can cover anything from a CEM attender, you know, Christmas, Easter, Mother's Day. And I'm not worried about offending any of them this morning. But it can cover CEM attenders to those who never miss a service. That can be religious. But when you use the term religiously, it covers a much wider range of human activity and endeavor. In some realms of life, it would even be appropriate to describe an avowed atheist or an avowed militant atheist as doing something religiously, maybe even opposing religion, but he does it religiously. So I went to the dictionary to find some more besides Dr. Hayakawa's definitions. The free dictionary says that religiously is extremely scrupulous or conscientious, and then, of course, a religious devotion to duty. American Heritage Dictionary says religiously means with extreme conscientiousness, and gave the example he came religiously every morning at 8 o'clock. It also means conscientiously or scrupulously. From dictionary.com, it means scrupulously faithful, conscientious, talks about religious care. The Urban Dictionary says religiously means doing something on a regular basis. Gives the example she does her homework religiously to get into a good college. Another definition from that same source is religiously as being scrupulous and faithful. And then gave the rather unusual illustration of he stared at the full moon every month religiously. The Wiktionary says that it means always. And gave the illustration, it is odd he gets so many cavities since he brushes his teeth religiously every night, rain or shine. And thesaurus, and by the way, is there another word for thesaurus? But the synonym within the thesaurus is that with extreme conscientiousness, and the synonyms are conscientiously or scrupulously. So someone who does something religiously doesn't necessarily have to be religious. They just have to be faithful, steady, regular in what they're doing. Jesus encouraged his followers to go to great lengths, even to follow him and his teachings religiously. In Luke 14:25, I believe it's in the New Living Translation on the screen, or should be, and I'm going to read it from the King James, so you'll get a double feeling of it from different translations. And there went great multitudes with him, and he turned and said unto them, if any man come to me and hate not his father and mother and wife and children and brethren and sisters, yea, and his own life also, he cannot be my disciple. And whosoever doth not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. So Jesus was encouraging his followers to be attendant to obeying him, being with him, walking in his way religiously. Luke also wrote about Paul's conscientiousness and scrupulous carrying on of his obligations, even in the wake of his stoning. In Acts 14:21, and when they had preached the gospel in that city, he's talking about Derbe, and had taught many, they returned again to Lystra and to Iconium and Antioch, confirming the souls of the disciples and exhorting them to continue in the faith. Sounds like he's saying, do this religiously. And that we would, through much tribulation, enter into the kingdom of God. You see, if you're doing something religiously, you are not doing it just when it's easy. You are doing it no matter what the situation. You are doing it regularly, faithfully, and completely. So I come back to the question that I started with earlier this morning. Are you religiously Christian? Are you Christian all the time? When it's hot, when it's cold, when it's easy, when it's not. If there were anything I wanted to be religious about, or do things religiously, it would be following my Lord. Are you religiously Christian?
Amen. Well, it is time to worship in our giving. If you will stand, and the ushers come. Caught you at the right moment, Brian, didn't I? It's all right. Let's ask the Lord to bless this offering, and we'll march. Jesus, we thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to give into your kingdom, Lord. We ask that you would bless this offering, Father, and use it, Jesus, for the furtherance of your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen.
Wonderful, wonderful, Jesus is to me. Counselor, Prince of Peace, mighty God is he. Saving me, keeping me from all sin and shame. Wonderful is my Redeemer, praise his name. Wonderful, wonderful, Jesus is to me.
Wonderful Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus.
Bye.
Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, we thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. We worship you, Lord. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, we give it all to you, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. We surrender, Jesus. Not our will, but thy will, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise your name. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song.
Would you worship him? Hallelujah, hallelujah. We worship you, Lord. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, Jesus. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of Jesus. I worship you, Almighty God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. I worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God, praise God. You may be seated. To all of our first-time guests, welcome. We are so happy that you are here, and I hope that you feel the presence of God, but also that you feel our love and our care for you. And if this is your first time, we'd love to get to know you a little bit better. And so following service here, we have a reception prepared for you. To my right, your left, as you exit the sanctuary. And we would love to have the opportunity to be in your presence, share a little bit of story with you, and be able to just make sure you know how much we love you and we care for you. To all the rest of you, I'm glad that you came. We heard about being religiously Christian, and I was waiting for my father-in-law to say, in sunshine or rain. As I was headed here, I thought, well, there's going to be some folks that are going to stay home today because of the rain. But I'm glad that you did not. And I'm glad you're here to worship together. Coming together as a congregation is about what God will do for us. But it is also about what God will do through us. So that even if you make an assessment that you can make it without a particular service, there may be somebody there who can't make it without you. Well, they've got God. Yes, but God works through his body. And you are a part of that body. You are important. You are essential. You're not replaceable. You're not expendable. And we are so glad that you're here today. Well, has anybody picked up on a theme on Sunday morning at all? Has anybody picked up on what I'm doing on Sunday mornings yet? I think you're going to pick it up from this morning when I put this up there. But if you go back a couple of weeks, I've been dwelling on the Holy Spirit. In fact, I've been kind of walking through sequentially from the end of Luke chapter 24, in which Jesus gives instructions about the importance. He's about to leave the earth. He's about to leave his disciples, and he tells them they need to go to Jerusalem and wait for the promise of the Father, which he's going to send, the Holy Spirit. And so I've just felt, I don't know how long I'm going to dwell on this, but I'm going to walk through. Now, in the midst of that, I'm going to do a few obligatory statements, which is, everybody understand the gospel includes repentance. You cannot be right with God without repentance. Repentance is probably a bad word to most of us, at least is to our flesh, our carnal nature, because repentance requires us to admit that we're wrong. How many of you are willing to admit that you don't like admitting that you're wrong? If I was really wrong, I would have known it and not chosen that position in the first place. Maybe you're not quite as arrogant as I am in that point, but all of us, in fact, the scripture speaks to it, that every man, every woman thinks they are right in their own eyes. Repentance goes straight in the face of that. The smarter you are, the harder it is to repent. Yeah, I know, I just nailed somebody. Maybe somebody's. But the smarter you are, the harder it is to repent. Because you have to bring your mind and your pride under subjection to the mandate that the only way you'll be made right with God is to repent. Because repentance requires you to admit that you're wrong. You can't get anywhere in repentance unless you admit that you're wrong. When you admit that you're wrong, though, that's not enough. You know, when the cop pulls me over, I know I use this example all the time, but when the police officer pulls me over on the highway, I've been going 85 miles an hour. He's clocked me with his gun, and he's going to write up the ticket. it's kind of a foregone conclusion that I got to admit that I'm wrong. But repentance requires a second element. It's not just the admission that you're wrong. It's the declaration, true declaration, that you want to change. Now, I got to be honest with you. I have really never been pulled over by a police officer where I am so glad he pulled me over. And I just, police officer, I don't ever want to go that fast again. I have to admit that. I don't. I've got places to go. I've got things to do. I've made my assessment of the road conditions, and I want to go. That's getting caught with your hand in the cookie jar. That's all that is. That's not repentance. Repentance is not just the admission of wrong. Repentance is also the declaration and the request of God, change me. Now, I can tell you by experience, you won't change overnight, but you won't change at all until you ask him to change you. And so you got to repent. The gospel is about repentance. Jesus said it this way, except you repent, you'll perish. That's not a real fancy way to say it, and it's also not a real, you know, that's not a good sales job. That's rather in your face. And yet, you're going to have to admit that you're wrong. You have to admit that you're a sinner. You're going to have to admit. You're going to have to stop rationalizing. You're going to have to stop, you know, contextualizing and saying, well, I do pretty good compared to. You know how we all do that. Compared to this person or that. And see, that's why I said, smart people, you have more of a problem with repentance because you got God has somehow, and society has trained your mind that you can weasel your way out of almost any scenario. Boy, somebody don't like what I'm saying, but I'm still going to have to say it. So, repentance is when you lay down all the weasel words. Now, the reason I'm speaking so blunt is, please understand, and maybe you don't think, particularly since I'm up here preaching and I'm taking everybody off, that maybe I'm not that smart, but you're looking at a guy that knows how to weasel. I can weasel with the best of you. There's not a single person in this place right here that can weasel their way around me. We might hold each other, but you're not going to weasel around me. You have to lay that down. You have to lay that down. Somebody here this morning needs to hear me. You have to lay that down. You have to say to God, God, I'm a mess. God, I'm a sinner. God, I am broken. Now, repentance by itself doesn't do much. Scripturally speaking, repentance by itself doesn't do much. But when you couple it with water, it's kind of like those things that you get that you got one part ingredient, but it doesn't do anything until you add water. Well, that's kind of how repentance works. Repentance doesn't do much until you add the waters of baptism to it. But the scripture tells us that when you repent and are baptized in the only saving name of Jesus Christ, what happens is those sins that you have admitted that you are broken by are removed. They're washed away. They're no longer are you held accountable by them, to them and for them. And in addition to that, you then have the opportunity to have applied to your life the most powerful name in all of the universe, and that is the name of Jesus Christ. And that changes things. That transforms things. That's why we baptize in the only saving name of Jesus Christ. Because the apostles understood and said it. Acts 4 and 12. Neither is there salvation in any other name. For there's no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. This is why in the book of Acts you never find them baptizing. You might find them simply baptizing and not telling you what they're baptizing in. But anytime they tell you what they're baptizing in, every single time you find them baptizing in the name of the Lord, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus Christ. Because there's something that happens when the Almighty God applies his name to your life. Paul uses language of adoption. You are removed from one identity, one life, and into another. You got a new identity in Christ. Those are essential. But as powerful as those two pieces are, there's nothing like the Holy Ghost. There's nothing like the Holy Spirit of God. And so I want to spend a little bit of time here today talking to you about another aspect of the Holy Spirit, namely power. And so looking at Acts chapter 1 and verse 6, I think I got control of the board there. I do. AV, I'm going to give you a break for a second so I can control for a sec. So when the apostles were with Jesus, now this is between his death, his resurrection, and his ascension. So he's died, he's resurrected, and now it's those 40 days or so where he is appearing to them. So when the apostles were with Jesus, they kept asking him, Lord, has the time come for you to free Israel and restore our kingdom? You see, if your agenda isn't God's agenda, you're going to have a little bit of a problem. And many people come to God with an agenda. They think there's something that God can do for them. And God can do anything. So they're not wrong. It just doesn't mean he will do anything. He can do anything, but he won't necessarily do anything. I've been asking God for all of my life, Lord, let me try just for a little while to be a billionaire. Let me try it. I really think between the two elders in my life and between my wife, I think we could set things up right. I think I could do it. God could do that. Doesn't mean he is. And to date, he hasn't. He hasn't even been kind enough to make me a millionaire. He said, I will provide all that you need, but I'm not going to give you a whole lot of surplus. I'm going to provide what you need. Now, maybe that'll change in the future. Maybe. I don't know. I leave that in God's hands. Just because we ask God to do it and just because God can do it doesn't mean that God will do it. So you got to understand that your agenda doesn't run things. God's agenda does. And so the disciples, they were kind of fixated on something. They wanted Israel as the kingdom of David reestablished. They wanted the Romans gone, and they wanted their own political autonomy and political freedom. I hate to break the news to you, but God is not losing sleep over the November election. Do you know how many rulers he's been setting up and taking down? Do you know how many messes around the world over thousands of years that he's dealt with? I promise you, Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton are not causing God to lose any sleep. He's the King of Kings. He's the Lord of Lords. He's the King of the whole world. Now, we have a responsibility. You need to vote. And God help us, it's a tough one to figure out. I agree. But with that said, don't lose sleep over it. Don't lose sleep over it. Because God has a larger agenda than just the things that we get focused in on. And these guys got really focused in. Lord, if you could rise from the dead, oh man, you can reestablish the kingdom. Yeah. Let's go. What kind of power is that? It was one thing to walk up to Lazarus' grave and call a man 4 days dead out of his tomb. Boy, that's some power. But you called yourself out of the tomb. Woo! Flick, there goes the Romans. Flick, there goes the Jews. Flick, there goes everybody else that's not supposed to be here. Reestablish the kingdom. So this is what they're asking. Lord, has the time come? Funny thing is time's never coming. God's not ever reestablishing the kingdom, not the way they wanted it, at least. So verse 7, he replies, the Father alone has the authority to set those dates and times, and they are not for you to know. My, my, my. Anybody that wants to talk to you about the end times, if they don't ever reference this verse, don't listen too much to them. If they don't ever reference this verse, then don't listen too much to them. Jesus basically said, there's a whole lot of stuff that you're going to want to tie down. You're going to want to get a hold of a date. You're going to want to control the agenda. Anybody in here willing to admit that you like to control the agenda? He says, it's not for you to know. You don't get to control this. And then verse 8, we're told, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit, this Holy Spirit that he told them to go to Jerusalem for, this Holy Spirit that earlier we've told that he's told them that it's going to come. You were baptized with water by John, but now I'm going to baptize you with the Holy Spirit. You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. And you will be my witnesses. You will tell people about me everywhere, in Jerusalem, throughout Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. Verse 9 tells us, after saying this, Jesus was taken up into a cloud while they were watching, and they could no longer see him. Verse 10, as they strained to see him rising into heaven, two white-robed men stood suddenly among them. They said, "Men of Galilee, why are you standing here staring into the heaven? Jesus has been taken away from you into heaven, but someday he will return from heaven in the same way you saw him go." Now, of course, the men in white clothing, probably angels, who stand here bearing this message, they speak of Jesus' return in a physical body. And there is coming a day when he, according to the scriptures, will return to this earth. And you will see an exercise of political power. You will see him take control of the earth. In fact, it will be the ultimate take control, because the scriptures, if we understand them correctly, say that he will destroy the heavens and the earth and start from scratch. Literally build a new heaven and a new earth. So don't mistake that God can exercise political power. He absolutely can. But for the disciples, what he was interested in focusing their attention upon was not the political power that they thought his resurrection could produce for them. No, he wanted them to focus upon the life-transforming power. That which would change their life so they would have something to tell others about Jesus. The reason that God has come in his spirit to live inside of you is not just to save you. Yes, it is to save you. It is to redeem you from your sins. It is to be your Savior. But in the process of saving you, in the process of transforming you, in the process of giving you power to do that which you in yourself do not have the power to do, he is providing for you a witness, a story. Now, I'm a little nervous right now. There's at least one lawyer in the house. There might be a few others. And so if I get my particular terms wrong here, forgive me. But a witness is not someone who generates a story. In fact, if I understand our court system correctly, if you generate a story, that's called perjury. It's called lying. And there's some severe costs that come if you perjure yourself in a court of law. You may not just generate or make up a story. It might be a grand story. It might be an interesting story. It might be a story that rivets everyone. But if it is not your story, if it is not that which has come from your experiences, what you bore witness to, then you can't say it in court. Even if it's somebody else's story in the court of law, you are not allowed to tell it. It's called hearsay. You don't have direct access to it. You're not the one who saw it. You're not the witness. Then you don't get to bear witness. And lawyers are required to go and find the person who can bear eyewitness to it, that can bear testimony to what they have seen. The Holy Ghost has come to save you. The Holy Ghost has come to give you power to transform your life. But in the process of transforming your life, he will give you a story. And it won't be one you made up, and it won't be one you heard from somebody else. It'll be your own story. It'll be your own story of brokenness. It'll be your own story of lostness. It'll be your own story of the problems and the issues of life, and how when he showed up, when he moved in, when he took up residence within your heart, then things began to change. And that story is your witness. In other words, The Holy Ghost is not just for you. You're for the Holy Ghost. Yes, God will transform your life. Many people, when they come to God, they are very focused on their agenda. What is their agenda? Their agenda is whatever crisis or problem has led them to be here, that is what they need God to deal with. Can I break some news to you? No matter what your reason is for being here, God has a whole nother agenda. He has a whole nother purpose. My dad came in contact with the first Holy Ghost-filled person. In fact, when he asked her out, the reason he asked her out is because he thought she was pretty. 5'2" and eyes of blue. Yes, we can look back and see that God was using her and her witness, her spirit, her attitude, all these kinds of things. But, first thing that I think caught his attention is he was a big man on campus at Hercules Incorporated. But he had done something to his leg. I forget what it was. Were you having knee surgery or... Yeah, and so he's on crutches, and so he's with some goofballs of his friends, and so they go ahead, and they slam the door on him. So, you know how it is. You got two sets of crutches, and one leg's gone, and how do you get the door open and then hold it open and get through? You can see the picture. So they're thinking it's funny. They're on the other side. Well, my mom, she came along, didn't think that was so funny, and so she held the door for him. I think that was one of the earliest occasions of contact with her. And so her Christian walk and her Christian spirit and her Christian attitude. But the bottom line is my dad asked her out because she was 5'2" with eyes of blue. Now, I got to be honest with you. I'm not wigged out by my parents being sexual creatures, but I do not see what my father sees in my mother, okay? I don't see that way. I don't see my mother that way. She's my mother. I don't see her that way. I'm not wigged out. My kids and my wife are wigged out. They just can't even imagine Grandma and Grandpa Moss being sexual creatures. That's just, oh. I'm not like that. Now, some of you are probably going, oh, you went there, preacher. What are you doing? Now, I'm not wigged out by that, but I don't see what he saw in her, okay? I think my mom's a lovely lady, but she's a mom. And somewhere in those early days of interaction with my mother, he asked this question, you're not one of those people that speak in tongues, are you? The evidence of God filling you with his spirit. Well, my mom bore witness to what she knew. Because at 18 years of age, she lay on a front pew of the little church in Myersdale, Pennsylvania, for hours on end as God had filled her with the Holy Ghost, and she began to speak in other tongues as God gave her the utterance. She didn't make up the story. She didn't tell somebody else's story. She just told her story. So she looks at this man who was interested in her and said, absolutely. I'm a tongue talker. Now, you got to understand, my mom was ambivalent. I don't know what she saw in my father. There's a side of her to this day that doesn't know what she saw in my father. But she did see something. My mom loves my father. She doesn't like him at times either, but she loves him at other times. And that's usually how marriages work. I don't know about you, but that's how mine works. I love my wife sometimes, and sometimes I love my wife because I said I was going to, not because I want to. Not because she's so lovable. In fact, sometimes I'm just being a pill and she's fine. It's just my attitude. But other times she's a pill. I know you can't believe that, but she can be a pill. So my mom, she actually, I think, secretly was hoping that it would kind of scare the goofball away. Yeah, I'm filled with the Holy Ghost. Some of you that are here today, you're still trying to wrap your brain around this because you spend enough time around us to find that we're pretty sane people. I mean, we're unique and we got unique personalities, but that's the whole world. But we're pretty sane people. We're pretty accomplished people. We're working good jobs. We function within society. We seem to have intelligence, and yet we actually believe. Let me rephrase that. It's not believe. Believe might mean I've experienced it or not. We actually maintain that God is living inside of us, and he takes over our tongue and our lips, and we speak in a language we do not understand. And we are not psychologically disturbed when it's happening. Yeah, it's a little weird. I'll grant you that it's a little weird. And yet, a witness doesn't comment on whether it's weird or not. They simply tell what they know. Jesus said, you got to go to Jerusalem, apostles. You've walked with me for many years. You've heard me teach you, but you got to get your own experience. You've got to get your own things to bear witness to. It's not good enough to just tell them about what you've seen me do. You've got to experience me in your life, transforming you, making you a new creature in me. Old things passed away and all things become new. You need to go and get your witness. So this power of God that is for you is not just to save you, it is to give you a witness. So my mom keeps telling my dad that he needs the Holy Ghost. He keeps saying he can be a Lutheran and she can be a Pentecostal and we can just get along. On a certain level, you can get along. I can get along with anybody. I don't care what they believe. I don't care where they are on a certain level. But I can't marry them. There's just too many things in life that we kind of got to see eye to eye on. Well, my dad didn't see that, and my mom did, so she just kept at it. And as I've heard the story, I don't know what the specifics were, but one night she had ticked him off. She wouldn't back up. And you got to understand, my mom is a bit of a bulldog. She looks like a nice petite, you know, 5'2", blue eyes. But she's a tough lady. She doesn't play around. If you ever want to, you ever want to see a side of her? If you want to see what I'm talking about, go waste money. Particularly church money. If you just want to test it, in fact, we can even make it right later. You just go ahead and do it and then interact with her and you'll see what I'm talking about. I don't care how tall you are, how big you are, any of that kind of stuff. She'll take you down. She's a tough nut. Well, she had ticked off my dad. Now, everybody that knows my father knows that he's no wallflower. Okay? This is a passionate man. This is a man with authority and power. He knows how to operate in that way. And she had ticked him off. I don't know what the specifics were, but she had ticked him off. And he burned his way out of there and roared up the mountain and went to his home. Was it that same night or was it just later? The next Friday, after that anger, after having burned it out, he's alone in his apartment on Friday night. He kneels down in front of a couch, which I've told you all is still in his basement. And he says to God, God, I don't know who I can believe and who I can trust. But I do know this, if I can't believe and trust you, there's no one to believe and trust. And so he talks to God about what this crazy 5'2", blue-eyed lady told him. Felt the presence of God enter that room. He feels, we'll never prove it scientifically, but he feels in that moment that it was minutes that went by and he didn't even breathe. It doesn't matter whether it was sensation or whether it was true. It doesn't matter. At the close of that period of feeling the presence of God, he opened his mouth to simply say to God in a good Lutheran fashion, thank you, God. And like Jesus told the disciples, out of his belly flowed rivers of living water. For what came out of his mouth was not English, but it was tongues as God gave him the utterance. Power. You have never met power like the Holy Spirit. You have never felt power like the Holy Spirit. It takes people who think this way, and when the Holy Ghost gets done with them, they think this way. It takes people who are bound going this direction, and when the Holy Spirit's done, they're unbound and going this direction. There is nothing in this world, social programs, education, money, wealth, all of the things that humanity tries to use to fix their lives, fix other people's lives. There is nothing like the power of the Holy Spirit. These men had walked with Jesus for 3.5 years. They knew what he taught. And he told them, he says, you must go back to Jerusalem. You've got to sit there and you got to wait because you won't do diddly squat until you have a witness. And your witness comes from receiving my Spirit. Because when I show up, things change. Things are transformed. And that is what you need. You need the power of the Holy Spirit. There's nothing more powerful than this Holy Spirit. Well, Lord, we want to reestablish the kingdom. That's none of your business. go receive my spirit. So today, I ask you, are you willing to let God transform your life? Maybe you've been looking for a human answer. Maybe you think the answer is going to be in who you marry. Maybe the answer is going to be in what kind of job you get. Maybe the answer is going to be in if I can just get the right amount of information through education that then will allow me to straighten life out. I'm here this morning to bear witness that in my life alone, the only thing that works is the power of the Holy Spirit. Things change when we receive the power of the Holy Spirit. Now here's the good news. You don't have to do anything to earn the Holy Spirit. It's a gift. It's free. It's available to you. But what you will have to do is be willing to have the Holy Spirit take over. This is why the smarter you are, the more trouble you have. Because as you are more and more reliant upon your mind, your brain, it's harder to let go. I know. I'm one of you. I live up here. I'm not an athlete. If I unbuttoned my nicely cut suit, you would see why I say I'm not an athlete. I'm not good with my hands. I'm not a technical person in that sense. I'm somebody that lives in the mind. It's how I control my world. It's how I do what I do. It's in my mind. And my mind is where my language comes from. I control what I say. See, God is not so fixated on you speaking in tongues. That may wig you out, that may bother you, but that's not what he's fixated on. What it is that you have to give up the power in order for his power to transform you. You have to give up the control in order for him to take control. You have to be willing for him to be the power that transforms your life. And that's going to require you not turning your brain off, submitting your mind. I've never turned my brain off once. I've never stopped thinking. I've never stopped pursuing education. But everything is in submission to the Spirit of God, because there is nothing more important in my life than the Spirit of God, for it is the power of God unto my salvation. It is literally God inside of me. Now, if you're just here to have fun, see what the crazy Pentecostals do, maybe you're here socially, maybe you're here because a friend invited you, we're glad you're here. Welcome. Enjoy the rest of the service. I'm not being flippant, just being straight. But if you're here because deep down inside, you may not know how to articulate it, you may not know how to say it, you may not know how to express it, but something's missing. Because what I didn't tell you is in that story of my father who saw the 5'2" and eyes of blue lady and all of that, is that my dad had achieved a lot of things. Pulled himself out of poverty, educated, on the fast track, corporate America. But his marriage had been destroyed. His three children were being yanked from his life. Still, things were going well. Teaching college, belonged to the country club. All the stuff the world tells you, this is what brings fulfillment. I'm not here this morning preaching to those of you that think you got life in hand and everything's good. I'm just going to wait till the life shows you that it's not. I'm here this morning preaching to somebody who goes, something's missing. something's missing. Something's missing. And I can't find it. I don't know what it is. And I can't figure out what it is. And I don't know why. At the end of a long day where I should be fulfilled and I should be happy and I should be just everything good, I don't know what I'm doing. And I don't know why I'm doing what I do. You're not having a crisis of career. You're not having a crisis of money. You're not having a crisis of position. You're having a crisis in which the Almighty God is reaching down into the inside of you, and he's calling to you, and he's saying, I have the power to fill that void. I have the power to transform that need. I have the power. But you're going to have to give up. You're going to have to let go. You're going to have to let me take over. When I do, I'll give you a story. And all I ask that you do is tell everybody else your story. Just tell them your story about me. I'm done. This altar's open. Would you come and pray? Jesus, I worship you today. Church, be in a posture of worship and praise. Partner with all of us together, creating an atmosphere where God can minister to the hearts and minds of those that are here. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Church, when you face challenges, even after having received the Holy Spirit, guess where the answer is? It's in His Spirit. Hallelujah. It's in giving up control. It's in submitting whatever it is, your sin, your brokenness, your problems, your issues, it's submitting them to Him. Hallelujah, hallelujah, Jesus. God, I worship you and I praise you, Lord.
Breathe on me.
Hallelujah.
Rain on me. Rain on me. Holy Ghost shower. Rain on me. Yesterday's gone. Today a man need. Holy Ghost shower. Breathe on me, breathe on me. Holy Ghost power, breathe on me. Yesterday's gone, today I'm in need. Holy Ghost power, breathe on me.
Rain on me.
Something. You know, in the Old Testament, God couldn't come in contact with his people, because if he did, they would die because of his holiness. We have examples of it. So how did God stay in the midst of his people? The Old Testament tells us that God created a plan whereby once a year the high priest would take blood. It was animal's blood. He would take it into the Holy of Holies, and he would place it, according to God's instructions, on certain places, and that would allow the presence of God to continue to live among his people, albeit inside of a tabernacle, and albeit the high priest only going in once a year. But still, he was in the midst of his people. This song that we were just singing, I want us to sing it again. There's wonder-working power in that blood. You know why there's the power in the blood? It ain't the blood. Yes, it is the blood of the sinless Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Yes, it was the sacrifice of Jesus on Calvary. But what God did in that sinless blood, once for all, is He made a way that now, because of His blood shed on Calvary, He doesn't just live inside of the Holy of Holies. He doesn't just perch between cherubim's wings in a tabernacle. No, now He lives in a tabernacle not made with hands. Your tabernacle, my tabernacle, your body, my body. That's why there's power in the blood, because the blood is what gives us the ability to receive, because of Calvary, His Spirit that then transforms our lives. That's why we sing there's power in the blood. Did you get it cued right? I'm ready to go.
There is power, power, wonder-working power.
It's not superstition. It's not hocus pocus. It's God performing the miraculous so He can live inside of you. And the power of all the universe is in you, changing you. Oh, wonder working power. That's why I won't baptize you in any other name than the name of Jesus, because that's the name whereby the blood is applied. Rejoice in it, church. There is power. Wonder-working power. One more time.
There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power
in that precious blood of the Lamb. Would you thank Him for it this morning? Hallelujah, church. Don't neglect the power that's within you. Whatever you're facing in life, don't forget you've got the power of the Almighty within you. Jesus, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I praise you and I worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise your name, Jesus. Praise your name, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God, praise God, praise God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God, praise God. I am so glad that God loves humanity. He doesn't love us because of how well we perform, because we are failures. The smarter we've gotten, the worse it's become. We literally live in an age, I don't know what it is currently, I haven't looked it up, I don't even know how they figure it out, but it's a no-brainer to know. We're in an age in which knowledge, innovation, is at an all-time peak. And we are worse than we have ever been at being just and righteous and holy and kind and gentle and loving. But God still loves us. And His power is powerful enough to transform. Oh, you want to... Hey, let me challenge you. If you don't believe me, just pick somebody in the church that you think, hey, that person, they don't have a story. And sit down with them. Just come up and say, tell me your story. And let them tell you where God has brought them from. Just let them bear witness. Just let them tell their story. I have absolute confidence. I don't even know all their stories. But as they share what God has done in their life, how God reached them, where they were when God began to reach for them, I'm telling you right now, it'll bear witness to you. And then it's up to you whether you want him to transform your life as well. Love him together again, church, as we dismiss. Jesus, we love you. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You are the most powerful being in the universe, and yet you love us. You don't want to destroy us. You want to save us. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your love, Almighty God. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God, praise God. Praise God, praise God. Praise God. And I'd highly encourage one of them that you go get the story from is go find out how a rocket scientist becomes a preacher. That's quite a story. I'm telling you. You think God can't do anything? That's quite a story. How God could take a rocket scientist and turn him into a preacher. Wow. There's hope for anybody. You're dismissed in Jesus' name.